hear me? Just to make sure that you are all in the right room, this is Macroeconomics 101 class. We're going to be covering a lot of territory. And if you're in the wrong room, stay anyhow. I don't know if you all were able to pick up this morning's Wall Street Journal, but an interesting article on the midsection about Indonesia growth slowest since 2009. Interesting, because what they're saying is it slowed down to 5.62% annually as of Q3, the end of September. And the World Bank is estimating it'll even out at year end of 5.6 GDP growth. Well, I got news for you. If that's slow, North America, except for Canada, and most European countries, Japan, Korea, will all trade you your growth rate here in Indonesia, because 5.6 is substantial. Last night, a friend of mine, an Australian friend of mine, he gave me some advice for speaking this morning, because he knows me well. He said, slow it down a little bit. He says, there are some people in the audience who are not necessarily speaking English as a first language. So for all the Australians in the audience who are unaccustomed to the King's English, you'll lean over to the person next to you and please have them interpret my presentation for you. Let's get into this. Megatrends, Asia. Next slide, please. I'm not sure if I'm on. Yogi Berra is one of my favorite philosophers, and Yogi says, it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future, but that's what we're going to try to do. Next slide. To see things in the seed is to see things into the future. So let's take a look at some of the future seed. For some reason, I'm having difficulty, technical difficulty. Next slide. Okay, I want to take you back in order to look at the seed so we can see the future. Oop. Okay, we're on. Think back to 1967, because I often do. Even though I'm only 39 years old, I can remember clearly 1967. In 67, there were no mobile phones of any kind. Computers required a skyscraper to operate in, because they were so big. And all of the electronics, most of the electronics we had, were still operating on vacuum tubes. Peter Thompson had just won the Australian Open and the Australian PGA. Australia was fully engaged with us, the Americans, in the Vietnam War. And of course, many things were going on. In Asia, we were in turmoil. I vividly recall this because it's the first time I entered into Asia. The Cultural Revolution in China was just starting. There were only about 530 golf courses in all of Asia, and about 500 of those were located in Japan. Again, the Vietnam War was peaking. Over 500,000 of us were in country. The Australians were with us. 50,000 Korean troops were in Southeast Asia. So I'm trying to paint a picture of what was going on in Southeast Asia not that many years ago. And of course, I began my introduction to Southeast Asia with an all-expense-paid tour. But it wasn't tourism at the time. The other big thing that was going on in Asia in 67 was something that went unnoticed by most people. And unfortunately, in the West today, in the Occidental countries, I think it's still unnoticed. ASEAN is the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. And not long ago, an American friend of mine, when I wrote an email to him about ASEAN, he came back and corrected me. He says, you're misspelling Asia. It's spelled ASIA. So that gives you an insight into really the general knowledge about Asia by too many people. Originally formed by Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand, and the Philippines, five other nations became members over the years. So now there are 10 nations in Southeast Asia that constitute the ASEAN organization. Back to reality, to the present, 46 years later. As was mentioned by Bill, 600 million people in Southeast Asia, significant population. They are consumers, and we have an emerging middle class. And as I said, sadly, too few people in the West really understand or grasp Asia. Many today think, oh, Asia, that's China. We are China-centric. In many ways, small business is a camp follower. China, China, China. It's not to take anything away from China. China is a great nation and a great people worthy of respect and recognition. But there's more to Asia than China. In 2015, the ASEAN Economic Community officially goes online. It's already being geared up. There are many conferences going on. Preparation is taking place. This is going to be an EU-like common market, with the exception of a common courtesy. However, if the Chinese have their way, they will have a common courtesy. It'll be the RMB. We'll see what happens. What's coming down are barriers. Barriers for mobility are going to come down in ASEAN. Workers, labor, and professionals will be able to travel freely between countries. So what effect is that going to have? It's going to be able to help buffer and even out the workforce in the 10 nations. Intra-Asian cooperation is taking place to reduce corruption. And corruption is the enemy of development, and I'm going to talk about this a little later. With ASEAN and the AEC, remember that, AEC, it'll be as common in the English language as EU very shortly. The AEC is putting teeth into dealing with corruption in some countries, okay? Trade and customs barriers are coming down. That is also going to be an impacting issue in corruption. The real key question here is, can the 10 nations, can the ASEAN 10, keep focused on common goals? That's what everybody is asking these days. Oop, wrong way, sorry. If you look at recent headlines, there's the one I just read today, and there are many every day, these are key indicators of what's coming at us very quickly. They speak of population issues in Northeast Asia and positive population issues in Southeast Asia. It's interesting if you read a lot of publications in business today, you will intuitively pick up the trend of where all this is leading to. ASEAN has positive demographics of population, and Northeast Asia has big problems, just as does Europe, and not so much the United States, because we have immigration that is actually buoying up our population. And that's why you see the Chamber of Commerce pushing for immigration in the United States against conservative forces who don't want it. It's business. It's the future. Let's take a quick look so we have a better understanding of the average worker's economic life cycle. You already know this. I just wanted to represent it graphically so it registers as we continue to talk about this. The average worker is a consumer until they get into their 20s, late teens and 20s, when they begin to start producing things. And then from the 20s, early 20s into the 60s, they are producing more than they consume. This is called the first dividend in economics for population. And that excess of production over consumption is what builds wealth in nations. Once they reach the 60s, they very rapidly become more consumptive again than productive. Now keep in mind that this is a big important life cycle for us in the recreation golf business, because it's that excess of production that translates into disposable income for your average person. And disposable income means our income. People spend it on recreation. It also means tax revenues for most governments. And without tax revenues, these nations are not going to be able to do the things they need to do as far as building infrastructure and feeding and building the engine that is going to create wealth even greater in Southeast Asia. But there's a second dividend, and countries like Japan are having to have a hard look at this, Japan and Korea particularly, because they're running out of labor. China, the other thing, the New York Times this morning, The New York Times this morning, there was an article about China labor and educated people in China refusing any longer to just simply take factory jobs. The Chinese, to keep their factories with people in them today, they're offering double-digit raises just to retain staff. Labor costs in China are beginning to really take off. They certainly are taking off with us in Korea. And the Japanese, any of us who have worked in Japan knows the situation there. Labor costs are increasing tremendously in Northeast Asia, and in Southeast Asia, it's not the case. What happened? Okay, so we're going to move ahead, and we're actually going to take a look at some of these demographics. Let's first look at Japan, because Japan is the worst case situation in the entire world. Its population demographics spell big trouble for the Japanese economy, and it's sputtering badly. If you look at the upper left-hand corner, that's 1950, and each one of those lines is an age grouping. On the left side are males, on the right side are females in that population group. After in 1950, after the Pacific War, as we call it in Asia, not too many people refer to it as World War II. After the Pacific War, there was a baby boom, just like in Europe and in North America. In Japan, people were thinking that the war was over, frankly, and they began to have children. So you see this pyramidal shape to the population demographics of Japan. But by 2010, it looks more like what took place in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. You see a mushroom forming in 2010. And as we project to 2050, this becomes even more pronounced, to the point where by the end of this century, Japanese population will have shrunk and stayed there, if they're lucky. Now, these demographics, you'll notice there's more females than there are males. I wanted to point this out. And by the way, these statistics are available on the internet. This is United Nations studies. It is also conducted by the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the Asian Development Bank. They're conducting their own information research, and it all verifies everybody is in sync on their data. When we look at China, again, the pyramidal shape, that means that there's more young people than there are older people. Now, that bodes very well for the future of any nation, because the younger people support the older people. By 2010, after a one-child policy, almost enforced in a draconian manner, we see this strange shape forming. And by 2050, again, the mushroom cloud is predominant. An interesting thing I want to point out about China, if you look closely, you will see on the left-hand side, the blue age groups, males, are outnumbering the females. It's an unnatural balance. It's a gender imbalance, and we're going to talk about that. South Korea looks exactly like Japan, with the exception that it's lagging. The Koreans are following, once again, in the footprints of the Japanese. It lags by 5 to 10 years, and that's a result of the Korean War in the 1950s. And by the way, this is only reflecting South Korea, not including the North. And the North could, in fact, be a wild card for Korean economics. And frankly, if they bring the North and reunify, their labor pool is going to be tremendously impacted. So that's an unknown card for economists at the moment. Now we come to Southeast Asia, the nations of ASEAN. You will see that the charts look much different indeed. A very healthy pyramidal growth in the 50s. 2010, you don't see the top heavy. It's still the bottom supporting the top. It's not in a collapsing situation. By 2050, it's projected to shrink, but not tremendously. It's a more subtle lowering of total overall population. And it hasn't shrunk down by the turn of the century. When we go to Malaysia, we see similar, except Malaysia is even more conservative. You just don't see the big mushroom cloud forming that's boding bad for the future. And by 2100, they've kept steady growth all through. This is important because I'm going to talk in a moment about what the economists are saying. The Philippines is the real sleeper amongst all the ASEAN nations. The Philippines has the healthiest demographics for the future as far as population is concerned. It says it all by just looking at it. I'm not going to go into every country, but those are the three top. Gender imbalance is a mega trend in Northeast Asia and in Eastern Asia that has to be paid attention to because this is going to impact economics. Imbalance of males over females. What do you do when you have 40 to 50 million excess males in your population that can never marry, never have children? When they start to age, who's going to support them? Because traditionally in Asia, as in many parts of the world in the past, it is the male who has supported and the children who have supported the parents. That's the Social Security system. India also has a challenge. It's a little different. India's gender imbalance was not caused by draconian government policy. It's caused by actual interference from the West. The United States for decades has been sending population control people in and funding population control in India. Culturally, it has caused an imbalance. In both countries, by the way, gender selection has been done through abortion, okay? There are probably 100 million females missing from the equation when you look at India and you look at China. This has economic impact for the future. And the thing that has caused it was not government policy in India, but outside influence with cultural mores. Males are more valued in India, and it's not just to carry on the family name like in China and support the parents. Males are considered more valuable because for when a young woman is married, traditional Indian culture, the family has to pay a dowry to the husband. And it is, for the average Indian, about a year's salary. So it's economics that are dictating the population in both these countries and the gender imbalance. As I said, India, ASEAN is not Asia misspelled, as some may think. Indonesia is the largest country in the ASEAN alliance. It's the fourth largest in the world. The fourth largest in the world. First China, India, United States, and Indonesia. Ask your average American on the street something about this, and they have no clue. I'm sorry. Small business people are a little bit better. The Philippines ranks 12th in the world in population, Vietnam 14th, Thailand 20th, Myanmar or Burma is 24th. Population is the key determinant for future economics. The key determinant, it's not the singular determinant, but it is the key foundational determinant. In the Northeast, they're in trouble. They have populations that, frankly, make their economic growth unsustainable. ASEAN nations have healthy, youthful population growth, their economic development, and growth for the next 20 years at least and beyond is sustainable. Again, remember the average worker life cycle. Again, this morning in the New York Times, this is the article I mentioned earlier, the Chinese workers refusing to just go to the factory any longer. ASEAN has been said to be the key to the Asian century. You've heard people in the West saying, well, this is the Asian century. And frankly, they're all thinking of China. Let's take a look at this. This is an indicator of gross domestic product. The data up on this board is from 2010. So it's a little bit outdated. But I've updated for the end of the Q3 that just completed. The statistics are now coming in, so you see where things stand. Now, the size of the bubble is indicative of the total size of the economic engine of that country. So we have a large bubble for USA and a large bubble for China and so on and so forth. The EU is viewed as an economic entity, and it's competing with the US and China. But where it's located in the chart, as far as how high it is or low it is, indicates how fast those economies are growing. Since 2010, China's economy has been sputtering. They're not having the 8-plus GDP growth any longer. The United States and Europe are low in their growth rate. That's why I said they trade Indonesia for the rate of growth like right now on a rifle bullet. If we take ASEAN as an economic entity, and in 2015 with the AEC, that's how it is, folks. It is an economic entity. It's the seventh largest economy in the world. It's larger than the economy of Russia. And notice the arrows. China's coming down. India's definitely plummeting. Korea is dropping. Japan's coming up, but still sputtering back about 2.6 GDP growth annually. And Abenomics, he's trying to do something to change that. They're downgrading the value of the yen to make their exports more competitive. But here in ASEAN, it's unbelievable. GDP continues to grow. And the size of the bubble is going to grow. Recent Q3 data is now coming in, as I said, and the Philippines, as of end of September, is on top of the heap. Remember that population growth in the Philippines, the charts I showed you? Keep that in mind. The Philippines right now, in some quarters, has exceeded the GDP growth of China. It's pushing up well over 7% a year. It's a hot engine, and it's producing. At the same time, in the Philippines, they're managing to keep inflation down, whereas the Chinese have a big issue. If you pick up the paper today, they're worried about inflation taking off in China, the cost of housing, the values of housing. So of all the ASEAN nations right now, Philippines is looking very good. And I think about a few years ago, I spoke to you about the same subject and kind of predicted this is where things were going to be going. Let's watch this. Sound? Okay, let me back this up.
I think 10 years from now, probably the same thing, probably the most exciting investment in the region. And there is also have to do is look at the age structure of the population. Countries like Indonesia have to realize that, you know, in 10 years, you still won't be able to address the opportunity that that market will be creating in terms of the Amazon growth.
There's an ASEAN who has a great future, 10 years will have a great future. Yes, sir.
But if you don't lose sight of ASEAN centrality, I think you'll see an ASEAN with more than double the GDP, more than double the per capita, with more than double the intra-ASEAN trade, and with ASEAN achieving its vision of becoming the hub of Asia trade, intra-Asia trade.
Thank you very much.
Now, back when I was at the Stanford Business School, we talked about small businesses, and in those days, it was a business that was under $100 million a year in gross sales. Today, it's probably $200 million. Most of the people in this room probably fall into the classification of small businesses. The difference is today, small businesses can afford to get the exact same data that global concerns get. In those days, to really tap in on the information flow to do strategic business planning, you had to be a global entity or a large corporation because it was expensive. The internet today, with communication and information and the educated workforce available to today's small business, there's no excuse for us not to do strategic planning, be it a trade association or one of your businesses or a golf club. There's no reason why we can't see it coming. One of the challenges and a mega trend taking place in Southeast Asia is the development of infrastructure. This could be the fly that spoils the ointment. Infrastructure build-out in Southeast Asia is absolutely critical and must happen. Transportation, energy, and water and sanitation. If you look at what's going on in the ASEAN 10, you can see that there is improvement needed in infrastructure. In the Philippines, a few years back, you can see that up until the late 1990s, 98, when the Asian financial crisis hit, infrastructure build-out and investment in infrastructure was just skyrocketing. Things were looking good. And then it hit, and it froze up. Capital froze up, and infrastructure was detrimentally affected. However, if you look at the trend now, we're up. These are, again, 2010 statistics. It's even better today. But by 2010, we're back into position. We're at the fourth highest level in 2010. So infrastructure is developing, and if you travel around Southeast Asia to Jakarta and KL and Manila, what do you see? The construction business is looking like Japan. Interestingly, a lot of the construction companies are probably from Japan and Korea. Infrastructure is critical. It's absolutely essential for modernization and development, and it's also essential in order to transport and make things mobile so that the population begins to share in this success. And it will help to build an emerging middle class. 2015, AEC is going to start selling bonds for infrastructure development in the ASEAN 10. The cash flows available for infrastructure development in ASEAN have tightened up in recent years. Capital is just not as available as it was before 2008, and you know, when the world economic crisis hit us. Let's look at what the big guys are doing. Airbus. Airbus has a back order of 36% on aircraft already ordered and in many cases paid for in Asia Pacific. They are projecting a 38% growth in the next 5 to 10 years. And here you can see it. By 2032, their studies and predictions, all backed up by statistics from UN, by IMF, by World Bank, by the Asian Development Bank, they're projecting that Asia is taking over air travel. But what is it? What does that mean? It means that Asians are traveling. Intra-Asia air travel for tourism and business. This is not expats and North Americans and Europeans flying in and flying out, or Asians going to the West to do business. This is Asians. This is a megatrend. It indicates there's great growth and health in these economies. When the AEC kicks in, and as I said, the mobility of workers and professionals, all the barriers come down, free flow of travel within ASEAN, we expect an immediate 5% improvement increase in tourism in Southeast Asia. This will be a combination of influx from Northeast Asia and Southeast Asian people traveling within Southeast Asia. Tourism boost is coming to ASEAN. Golf needs to be aware of this. Golf needs to be looking at destination properties for these people, not just the private country club model that is killing us. Domestically, the PRC will be driving the airline air travel business. It is going to be the largest segment of air travel through 2013. Again, Airbus statistics, this is right off of their publicly available information, their stockholders' reports. Middle class is growing, and this is a mega trend here in throughout Asia, but particularly in Southeast Asia. They expect that the middle class will double within 10 years. That's consumers, folks, and those are potential golfers. If we sit back and don't pay attention to this, we're going to hamstring the golf business. I can tell you, I'm involved in the scuba industry, and scuba is paying attention. And by the way, when I'm diving in the Philippines, I don't see Americans flying in and not so many Europeans, and not so many predominantly Japanese. Now I'm seeing masses of Chinese and many Koreans going into the Philippines scuba diving, no matter where you go. There's always Chinese groups coming in. And the exciting thing is I'm seeing Southeast Asian instructors. The instructors who control the dive industry are no longer Australians, North Americans, or Europeans. We're training local people. This is another thing we have to do to capitalize on these mega trends. We need Asian people in the leadership roles, not only expats. India has voted with their travel. ASEAN, Southeast Asia, is the destination of most Indians today. And again, you can see the emerging middle class mega trend represented here by Bank of America, Merrill Lynch studies. Another mega trend is energy. Southeast Asia is going to become a mega producer of energy in the world. It has untapped oil reserves, and this is what's also driving some of the issues of territorial disputes in Southeast Asia between China and its neighbors here in the south. It's not necessarily a war drums going on. It's business and economics. Everybody's trying to make sure they're positioned to tap in and capitalize on this mega trend. Summary, real quick. Everybody's talking about it, from Canada to Australia. Number one, ASEAN coming online 2015, common market. This is a mega trend. Shifting of population demographics, second mega trend. Northeast Asia aging, Southeast Asia youthful, and a healthy future ahead for decades and scores of years to come. Massive gender imbalance is a mega trend in India and China, and it's going to impede their economic development, and it's going to impede their ability to sustain the rates of growth that they've experienced. Infrastructure and build out of Southeast Asia is a mega trend. You can expect to see more construction. That means more opportunity for developing golf courses if we play our cards right and if we have strategies in place to deal with it. Increasing inter-Pan-Asian travel, another mega trend. Golfers, that means golfers from Northeast Asia coming down here, it's already happening. I got guys from Vietnam and Thailand and the Philippines calling me, Jim, what do we do with all these Koreans that are suddenly emerging on our doorstep? How do we deal with them? What are the cultural norms for showing them good service? And the emerging consumer class in Southeast Asia. This is a relative middle class. It's not the middle class with incomes like we're used to in North America and Europe. This is a relative middle class, and they are going to be consumers, they are going to have disposable income, and they're not going to be spending $1 million or $500,000 for a membership and a private club. But by golly, they will spend money to enjoy golf if we have public access facilities available to them at a relative middle class price. And that can be profitable. Our industry has to pay attention to this and knock off this insane private exclusive country club only. You know, Sentosa, $500 fees. Sky 72, my operation, we do 400. That kind of is an entry barrier for your average golfer. Golf is not slowing down in Asia. It's still pent up. We have just put price barriers and access barriers in place. The architects need to get with it, and with the finance people and with the potential developers, tourism authorities, local authorities. 80% public golf courses in Australia, 60% public golf courses in the United States. St. Andrews started and remains a municipal golf course. What is going on? Time to change the model, folks, and we'll see our growth. Southeast Asia is becoming a mega energy producer. This is going to bring mega capital into the region of ASEAN. All adds up, significant golf growth is certain in Asia if we are ready for it. Thank you very much. I hope I presented some useful information.